everybody. Welcome to the, what's this panel called? This is, are we the men? No, tomorrow is the men.
What is this?
This is, welcome to the Liam, Sam, and Roger Hour, where we will answer your searing questions about global political structure. I guess we're just going to talk shop and answer questions and stuff. I'm Liam O'Brien. I am an actor and a director in the world of games and animation. You might have heard me as Illidan Stormrage in World of Warcraft, or Nightcrawler, an angel in the X-Men, other stuff. I also play D&D every Thursday night.
Hi, everybody. Whoa. My name is Sam Riegel, and I am a person. I do acting stuff and voice directing stuff and other non-stuff. I've played all sorts of roles. Let's not get into that, because I don't remember them all. No, I was Donatello in Ninja Turtles a while back, and I played... recently, I was Metal Bat on One Punch Man, and I direct a bunch of shows, animation shows, for Disney and other places. And I'm also on his D&D show, our D&D show. I play a gnome, and he poops on beds.
I'm a voice actor as well, and I do voices and characters and all sorts of stuff. And if anybody has a question about what we do, you guys can just ask me.
Yeah, is this just a Q&A question?
Yeah, right.
I think so.
Okay,
I think so.
Well, then one at a time, we should take people to walk on down to this mic and say
a little pep in the step.
My name's Jen. I've been playing D&D for a few years. I personally watch pretty cool, and I love you all. Sam, you're an amazing bard. I'm playing a bard in the next campaign. How
would
I play the bard the best?
I'll be the one to answer this one. When you're D&D, you want to make sure that, you know what, actually, Sam, you go ahead and take this one.
Well, I always tell people that you, even though I sing on the show sometimes, you do not have to do that at all to play a bard. Bards are storytellers. Poets, limerickists, they can be guitarists, flutists,
flautists.
If you want to commit to being bard, just remember that your bardic powers can come from all sorts of creative places, and that you don't have to necessarily sing to do it. When we started playing, I just had a stupid app on my phone that I would press, and it would go like, and that was the font of inspiration. But I would say commit to it, be a performer, embrace that whole theatricality of it, and you'll go far.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
One word concept for your bar: fartiste.
Thank you. your name?
Hi, I'm Eric.
So, okay, sorry. Question.
So I asked this question to Roger to long ago, but I'd like to hear your guys' input. So I actually read that you don't go to that many cons that often. However, SacAnime is the convention that you have gone to most almost every single year. Is there any particular reason what makes you keep coming back to SacAnime over and over again?
The fans.
Big dots on the face and all that kind of stuff. And now performance capture and everything. So I guess they are improving the way that they produce the content.
Well, also I think for games, they care about the performance more. Like when we started doing games, it was just dumb.
Yeah. Well, we started with Pong and went from there. So like, what do you need for Pong? Not much. What do you need for RE1? A little more. What do you need for RE5? Quite a bit more.
Yeah, a little bit more, yeah.
Some people care a bit more about the performances in games and stuff. But in terms of just being social with your fellow voice actors, I feel like everyone's been pretty cool the whole time.
Absolutely.
And it's always nice to see new people come in too. And everyone's pretty nice in the voice acting industry. We're all friends and we hang out and look at each other's astrophotography.
Pandering yet again.
Yeah. So
hey,
the audience. When
I say pander, you pander.
Hey.
It's blue lava head. Right, that's the last one. Blue lava head.
I have signed on all the games and all the games you guys did on the past. So I noticed that some of the games that I played get turned into a televised series or a movie series. What are the chances for that to happen in the future to become anime?
For which game? Just for any game that we work on?
Yes. Like just like you did Sonic and you did the Tails.
Oh yeah. I don't know about the Tails game. I haven't heard about any of the Tails. Well, Tails actually one of them became an anime series, right? Isn't there like a Vesperia?
Tails
of
Vesperia the X.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
The question is, why do some video games get chosen to be made into some sort of animated film or series?
Yeah, like one of the.
I think generally a bunch of people sit in a room and go, oh, this game made a bit of money. You want to make a little more money?
More money.
Well, how can we do that? Well, we can sell cereal. Large boxes. Oh, animated series.
Yeah, Resident Evil O's. eating the T-virus.
It's sort of mysterious to us how the inner workings of these gigantic corporations that decide what becomes a movie works. But yeah, there's always a chance. Even an obscure series that you liked from long ago could get pulled back up and made into a something. But it will probably be ruined by Hollywood. So.
Thank you.
Sure.
Well.
Who's next? Super.
First of all, you guys are all awesome. Last night was awesome. The true podcast, you and Cody and Ali, all awesome. So just right to the point, this question for Roger, if you can, could you sing the opening line for Five Crossing Cody for the musical Man of Mancha at the end of the Fantastic Three?
Good Lord, no. What is the opening line? Does anyone in here know I, Don Quixote, from Man of La Mancha, but it's a song?
Yeah, it's a
song. Oh, we're going to Google. If you can get a single one here, because I don't.
Let's get the words.
Holy cow, look at this guy. All right, let's see. And of course, it's just lyrics, so I don't know the melody of anything.
And then
to bear with unbearable
minimum title.
What can I get for 12?
say $7 on it. Yes, it does.
He pushes forward two Pepsi bottles and a packet of Mentos.
Fly.
Huh? What'd you say? Assume it's at least $1 million for each of you.
Okay, $1 million each. Well, you know, at Comic-Con, at San Diego Comic-Con, I saw them trying to sell those land speeders for kids. Have you seen those? Mm-hmm. You didn't see those? Oh, they're so cool. It's like a little land speeder, but it's for like a kid. And I would buy one of those for my kids. And then I would take the rest of the money and put it in a gift certificate.
They're terrible people. I would give it all to charity. I don't even know who I'm working with anymore. I can't believe you guys are talking about this. Cryogenic sleep chamber.
Yeah. And a monkey's.
You guys have 2,000 years. I have my monkey.
I would say this, when I was growing up, I had a goal. I had 3 goals in life. I've met none of them so far. One was to own a massaging chair from the Sharper Image. One was to have a bumper car track in my basement.
That would be cool.
Fully operational bumper
car. That would be cool.
And the third was to have a bathroom that looked like an airplane bathroom. That would be cool in your house if you're like...
With like the super suction flush thing?
Yeah, and like when you close the door, it like makes the sound of like...
And you, every 30 seconds you just hear somebody going...
Projecting so much machismo and confidence. We sort of ooze with confidence, but really, underneath, we are very insecure people. Actors are extremely insecure and need constant reassurance and positive feedback and constructive criticism and applause and pandering. You want someone that can make them feel at ease and in a comfortable environment so that they can just create. That's like the number one thing. And, you know, also being able to read the source material and figure out the tone and the rhythm and the pace. And that's all secondary. Just having a cool lady or dude who makes everyone feel comfortable. That's number one priority.
Thank you so much.
Stuff was all super excited, super high pitch. I say, like,
Bear puns!
Bear puns, but how you can't come up with one on the spot. You're very, very attractive, and I want to make out with you!
Everybody needs to have their own theme song, is they? Because this long walk down in front of everybody.
You went with the Sanford and Son theme song.
Oh, what?
Earlier.
At least you caught that. We're dating ourselves.
I was a neighbor. I didn't know. Big fan of all you guys, by the way. Because we're going to each do like a dad joke, like Alien, Phoenix Wright, and that's the other.
A dad joke?
What kind of bees make milk? Boobies.
Wow. You're doing dad jokes?
It's a good dad.
I don't know if you're doing the joke. You're done.
Accelerating faster than you, like as Liam says, it does take time, and so you have to be not only okay with being in it for the long haul, but also being okay with like looking at other people proceed slightly faster than you, and just being like, okay, well, I'm just at my own pace, and that's okay. So you have to have a little strength of will to persevere. That too, especially if you live in a town like LA, where you know, you do see the occasional person who just shoots ahead and has a sudden megastar, and you're like, why can't that be me? It's not great.
It's entrepreneurial too. In the beginning, it's the worst part about it is that you're having to fight the balance between having a healthy enough ego. ego to sit there and believe in yourself and say, I think I can do this, I think I can bring something to this that might be different or unique or that is inherently me that isn't Sam or Liam or any other actor that's out there, while also trying to feed yourself or a family or having the crushing self-doubt that you're facing every day when the phone doesn't ring or all those things are just, it's just a process. And it's like trying to find that balance between I can do this, and just because it didn't happen this week or just because somebody blew up and is, you know, getting their moment doesn't mean that I won't get mine, but that's a hard thing to do. And so it's kind of like trying to maintain momentum in like small increments so that the mountain, the huge, the enormity of the dream doesn't crush you, and just sit there and keep trying to pick off little goals, you know. Oh, I revamped my website, I did this, I did that, like constantly reinvesting in yourself and just hoping that it's going to eventually take hold. It's not the easiest thing, but everybody up here has a completely different story about how they got started, and that's why when he was saying there is no one way, it's kind of like you're finding your own way in this journey, and there's no roadmap. It's just completely up to you.
Excellent. Thank you.
Good luck.
Our game has served as both of those for me. I am never going to teleport into the taint of a dragon or jump off a high ledge and swing on a rope and leap at a floating eyeball. So that part's escape. You know, I'm doing things that I'll never do in real life, but there's no doubt that we're all in the moment, having no idea what the hell is going to happen next. Toying with, experimenting with, just like if you were playing friggin' Ophelia. We're working through, you know, inner demons or that we have or that we wonder what it's like to have. And I definitely think that I've used the game to confront things in my own life, and I've also used it to laugh my ass off and, you know, disappear from view laughing at this guy. Art can be anything.
All of us get asked a lot of times, about roles that we played and if they're like us and if they're, you know, what part of you is in Teddy or whatever it is. For some of those roles, it's like, well, I only did that for 4 hours one day, so it's not really like part of me. But for the roles that we played for longer periods of time, like Roger's done Sonic for ever. And these critical role characters that we've been playing now for years, then especially on that, because we're sort of creating and writing the story as we go, it definitely, playing Scanlan has definitely revealed things about myself be them stupid or not. Some of my own personality certainly is in the character, and vice versa. It's been fun to explore this character and how it can affect me, and how I've gotten to do some things, especially with Scanlan, where like I've explored attitudes and moods and stuff that I have never experienced in my real life, but I've gotten a chance to sort of like game them out in our story in ways that it almost feels like I'm, you know, writing a novel or something. Like, it's really cool and exploratory, and I would definitely fall on the side of, you know, it's exploratory and real, and that's the coolest stuff. The escapism is always going to be there also, and it's definitely entertaining, but I love the stuff where you're really like getting into character and making the character real, even if it's not 100% real. So.
I don't feel human feelings, so I don't know what they're talking about. I just phone it in and read out loud.
It's a lot of time with SEO, though.
Yeah, no, it's everything. Literally everything they're saying is very true. That SEO was the same kind of thing because it was a long time of like getting to portray the character. And what is kind of sad is that so often we're called upon to just show up. It's one of the reasons why when somebody asks a question like, "What's your favorite line as this anime character?" Very often, some of the sessions are literally you show up, you've just driven through LA traffic, and they go, turn to page 477, you're 26 years old, you're out to avenge your father's death, and you kind of have like a thin voice, and and then you and so you don't really get a lot of times. It's very often like the pace is like called upon to just, it's like shut up and dance, you know, like create this thing real quick, we're on a timeline, we gotta get going. So it's rare, but when you do get those moments to really kind of sink in, it's neat. This career can help broaden your horizons in many other ways and can kind of open your mind to thinking differently and also understanding that in those moments you have a responsibility to try to do this to the best of your ability because it might really be influencing somebody else, or especially with video games, the interactive world is so different than the passive world of film because, I mean, we've had people who just come up, you know, and they can't believe that they're meeting the voice of this character that to us might have been a gig, right? To them means so much more because they were in a hospital bed laid out after surgery and spent, you know, 6 weeks just playing a video game in which they've fallen in love with all the characters and that kind of thing. And so that interactive thing, you have a chance to sometimes really be a part of that. That's cool. What was the question?
Sing. I have an observation too. It wasn't your question, but just listening to all of us talk about this, one of the things that is common for everybody who kind of rises to the top of this field is being really good at cold reading, being able to do things on the spot. Because there are games where you'll get scripts and you'll memorize, but that's not the majority of the work. The majority of the work is show up, you've never seen it before, they maybe give you a like 60-second description, and you're in. So people who are good at improvisation and cold reading and being able to leap in, throw themselves into the world in a second is what gets a lot of people ahead. I remember a story, I wouldn't say who it was, but a director was telling me about directing an actor, someone who was coming in from the TV world to play a lead in a thing, and he was like getting into it. And he'd be like, okay, hold on 1 second. No. And the way things are budgeted, like you've got a certain number of lines you got to get done in an hour, and they would have to wait for him to like ramp up into 12 of those no's. And that's just never gonna. There's no time for that. There's no room for that. So cold reading, quickness.
Anyway, and you had a good question. One focused a little bit more on the gameplay, in my opinion.
But I got to be a part of two really cool video games, and that is my favorite thing.
That was my favorite thing!
As a voice actor, you get free Starbucks in every location. No, you do not get a freestyle battle. I think my favorite aspect of being a voice actor is that I get to play characters that are unlike me in body. Because as a face actor, you know, you kind of got to look like the role that you're portraying, even on stage. I mean, there's makeup and stuff, CG, but for the most part, you have to be similar to the character that you're playing, but as a voice actor, not so. You could be a giant transforming robot or a small blob-like creature or all sorts of stuff that you would never get to play. Good guys, bad guys, young guys, old guys. You never get to do that as a face actor or factor, as I call it. But you do as a voice actor, and that's pretty amazing. Here's the mic.
What was the question again?
Your favorite part about your job? What is it?
The job itself. Yeah, it's so much fun, and it's the ultimate theater of the mind, kind of old school radio play type of acting. And we pride ourselves on, there's nothing I enjoy more than watching somebody who comes into an ensemble record of an animated series where we've been working on something for years, and somebody who might have been on like a show on the CW or something walks in with a little swagger, and they're like, oh, these voice actors, I'm gonna come in as a, perhaps you've seen me on, and they do that thing, they're like, okay, so what's my motivation, or where to get, it's like, we're all cutting loose and you're knocking out the lines and having a great time, and they suddenly they're in unfamiliar territory, and they suddenly are the uncool kid in the room kind of thing, whereas we're the cool nerds that, you know, seconds ago they were sort of looking down their nose at us kind of thing. The job is a lot of fun, and usually we bring them right into the fold and start doing, you know, goofy stuff to have them understand, like, it's fun and it's energy, and we have to direct all of our performances to here, and it doesn't matter what you look like, all that stuff. I mean, I know I look a lot like Ezio. But, you know, if I was to try to go up for anything Ezio-related on camera, they would just laugh me out, right? Well, but that's the beauty of what we get to do, is that, like you said, I mean, I don't look anything like Sonic the Hedgehog, but if I can sound like it, then cool, or Ezio, then cool, or Chris Redfield with gargantuan tree trunk biceps, like, you know, we get to inhabit these things that we would never, ever, ever be able to do in another setting. It's just a blast. It's too much fun.
Well, thank you guys.
Thank you.
And please don't judge me for running out right now. I have a gaming tournament.
Do it, my man.
Someone is doing this at us, which means that my headlights are on my car outside. So, 10 minutes, I see. that dancing all night or whatever it was called was amazing and weird, and just being able to like vocalize Teddy doing dancing moves and stuff was.
I guess I learned a lot about protein working on Persona's. That's all I got to talk about. We're going to talk about protein. Suavely talked about protein.
Well, Atlas knows the Persona 3 dancing game, so you might be next. Okay.
Thank you.
Sister on the walk of shame. I mean, worst slash best.
I don't remember which times I rolled one or just badly, but I certainly liked, there's no spoilers, but the last the live show that we did a couple weeks ago, I loved failing my my save against the love potion thing. That was a fun failure. Sometimes, a lot of times, failure is the most fun stuff in the show.
2 or 3 weeks ago.
Thank you.
Hey, what's up, guys? I'm a big fan of all your work. I was wondering, what pieces of advice do you have to share when it comes to the practice side of things, or just honing your vocal skills in general?
Practicing? I didn't hear that. Could you ask the question one more time? I didn't get the whole
thing. Yeah, the speakers are all facing away from us, so we can't actually hear anything that you guys are saying.
When it comes to the practice side, what do you guys typically, like, what advice do you have when it comes to practice and just honing your vocal skills?
Practice. Gosh, I feel like there are classes out there, although I'm always wary about sending people towards classes because there's no guarantees for any class. And I think most of us have just learned by doing. So hopefully, if you're interested in this kind of work, you're going down the path just to be an actor and working on plays or working on somebody's student film and then their independent film and just get reps at that. And then as you try to segue your way into voiceover, you know, you do a different thing if you're on a stage and projecting to the back row to working the mic. Like if I were on camera or on stage, I could not play Hill in the Storm Rage. I have to really eat the microphone. So you learn mic placement and what you're able to do with the equipment, but that just comes from repetition, really. So, I don't know, it's the same thing, it's just like jump in and figure it out after you jump.
I would just say, I always recommend improv classes or an improv something, like join an improv troupe. That just helps you with anything in the business, be it writing or acting or embodying different characters, or thinking on your feet or being funny, learning what audiences like and don't like. It just helps you be like a cooler person in life just because you are taught to just say yes to things. And everyone likes a guy who's just, you know, like, yeah, sure, I'll do it, whatever. Yeah, let's go. It's a good life lesson, too.
I don't know, thank you, a little more to this side. The character creation side of things, because I don't know, a lot of people ask, like, what's your warm-up, what's this, and I don't know many people that have a very stringent, even on the voice acting side of things, like, we're not taking 10 minutes before a session and doing all the weird actory stuff. But I would say that, like, I've heard guys like John DiMaggio talk about the way they came up with the voice of Bender, and it's this notion of taking something from here, and plugging them together to come up with a third sort of character. And that's something to listen to, like listen, like and pull from family members, a funny neighbor. David Kaye is somebody we work with, and he has an aunt that he talks about that always has this, when she talks, she when she agrees with somebody, she always says, yeah, 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 but she says it while she's inhaling. So it's already like, oh, they're going down to the pond today to go ice skating, and she's like, yeah, 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 yeah. And I was like, that's a character. I'm like, that has to be incorporated into something. Like, that's genius. Like, you know. So that thing of like looking, listening to the world around you and trying to understand like what makes that voice unique or that sort of thing, and can I mimic that? Can I? And then if I can I take it and make it my own? That's something to just try to like be aware of, I guess.
All right, awesome. Thank you guys so much.
Big fan of Critical Role, been recently watching it. Real question for Liam and Sam. If you had to remake your characters, what would you make them as?
Choose a different
race and class, and then what would you make?
So that they were not the same thing?
Same character in a different body?
Like, if you had to restart the campaign, okay. You weren't making Scanlan.
Well, that's kind of what we're figuring out now for the next campaign.
Yeah, the story may reset at some point soon. Who knows when?
Yeah.
One long, continuous, ongoing story.
It's been one story for 4 years now. We started broadcasting the show. Yeah, same characters. I don't know. We've been talking about this a lot, just knowing that that we may have to roll new characters soon. I mean, I think if Scanlan were to inhabit a different body, he wouldn't mind being in a handsome human body, just because there's many more ladies to pick up that way. But in terms of new characters, there's some cool ones out there. I was just introduced to the Tabaxi race, the cat people, which is really weird and cool. And then there's all sorts of weird monstery guys and little guys. Liam knows more about this than me, though.
I love halflings. Yeah. I really like halflings for characters. I loved playing that cleric, if anyone watched the most recent episode. And I'm putting my backpack in favor for a rainy day. But as far as what we're going to do for the next campaign, we'll just leave that a surprise. Sure, thank you.
What is the one role we wanted but didn't get?
Yeah.
I told you this before, Roger. I auditioned for Ezio. Yeah? No, I did. I think I made him sound like Mario. I am a clown in the building. Anything handsome.
Everything everybody else has done, I think. It's like, there's constantly, like
Ben 10.
All these other things. Well, anything, yeah. It's like, something that you haven't done. Like, we actually share a lot of admiration for one another in this industry, and we're always trying to mimic each other very often. And there's nothing more enjoyable than when somebody's not in the room, and they ask you to do what's called scratch for the actor that's not there, and you get to hear what we all think the other person sounds like, and then skewer them with it, kind of thing. But really, truly, it's like everything that we haven't done. And it's always an honor to do a particular role, but when you hear other people that you're jealous of do stuff, you're like, oh man, if I could do that, that'd be so cool.
I think the question was more like, what was the role you tried?
I don't know, that was your question. You get one. Where you define your question. Besides, Timmy's not even his real name. That's my handler. And his name is Juan Carlos.
And I learned that today.
I've got a real answer for you. I was in the final running for the Joker that Troy booked. But we're all like friends, so it's constantly you're like, God damn it, Mike, you're really good at that. You're really good at that.
So I was a line cat, but after listening to your whole panel, I actually have a question. When you were little, what was your dream job? What did you want to be when you grow up?
Veterinarian.
My dream was to not have a job. I succeeded. Real job, big job. I briefly wanted to be a forensic pathologist. You know those dudes
why
who
do you have such specific
examine dead bodies? And then my mom told me what that was really about, and I was like, oh god, that's awful. That sounds terrible. My dad's a scientist, an astronomer, so physicist, astrophysicist, but it's on the list. I don't know, I saw a TV show once and I was like,
Mom, dead people, I want to
play. I wanted to be an astronaut. I think it was an astronaut. And then one of my earliest memories is as a little boy, I thought tow trucks were the coolest thing. But this is how old I am. They didn't look like tow trucks do now, like flatbeds and things like that. They literally had the giant hook on the back and all that. But as a little boy, I didn't know what they were called. It's on the hook. I called them hooker trucks. interesting things here in the neighborhood. That and a garbage man, because garbage men used to ride on the side of the truck, and it was the coolest thing in the world to me. And when we would go to the grocery store, and my mom would be pushing the cart, I would ride on the side of the cart, like I was pulling off the cereal boxes and throwing them in, you know, being an astronaut garbage man, hooker truck operator.